What is going on, guys? Welcome back to the channel, and this is my review of the first episode of The Book of Boba Fett. Boba Fett actually appeared in the Star Wars Holiday Special in 1978, serving for the crime lord Jabba the Hutt, while seemingly killed in The Return of the Jedi after falling to the Sarlacc pit. He's since appeared in Star Wars media set after the film, confirming his survival. Not just that, but I'll go into the comics in a second. Now, the Mandalorian TV show is where Boba Fett made his comeback. In this spin-off series, The Book of Boba Fett and his first episode kind of delivers what we all expected. To tell us the truth about what happened after Return of the Jedi, I know we've all got questions about how did he get out of the pit. Some of us kind of really knew because we read the comics. But this series is only 7 episodes long. And if you thought he had it tough being inside the Sarlacc pit, that was the easy part. We've long waited to hear about the most feared bounty hunter in the galaxy, escaping from 1,000 years of pain and suffering in the belly of the pit. It used to be the biggest gap in Star Wars lore, but the good news is that the TV series proves that the comics were kind of canon. In an earlier comic book, he formed a psychic bond with the Sarlacc and used that to basically trick his captor into enabling his escape. Now, this kind of doesn't really play out that way, but it's close. In Chuck Wendig's Aftermath trilogy of novels, it's revealed that the Sarlacc was fatally wounded after Jabba's ship barged into it. So the creature, from what we knew, in terms of being alive or not, it wasn't, it was dead. And that kind of confirms what we see here as well. So the creature from which Boba Fett escapes in the Disney Plus show after Return of the Jedi is a dead one. There's no signs of it being alive and the acid rotting inside of its stomach, which is kind of clear by its inactivity. We don't hear it screaming or shouting, or we don't hear it doing it or moving or anything like that. It's just still. So this is emphasized by the episode itself. They don't really tell us in many ways that it's dead, but you can't see anything happening. So we have to take into account that this follows the comic in terms that the Sarlacc was dead. Now, Boba Fett wakes up in the belly and spots a dead stormtrooper. Running low on oxygen, Boba Fett uses the dead soldier's oxygen supply to replenish his own and then fires a flamethrower to burst through the side of the Sarlacc to escape. It also flashes back so that the fans can see a young Boba Fett meeting Ewan McGregor's version of Obi-Wan Kenobi before the child witnesses his father's brutal death at the hands of Jedi Master Mace Windu, Samuel L. Jackson. Now, The Mandalorian is set 5 years after Return of the Jedi, so the setting for the series is roughly about the same, maybe a year moving onwards, because we have no idea how long he was in the Sarlacc pit, but it couldn't have been that long. So when Din Djarin, Mandalorian, embarks on his journey with Baby Yoda's Grogu, Boba Fett discovers that Mando has his old armor, which belonged to his father, and recently came into the possession of Cobb Vanth. Now, despite being introduced as an antagonist, Boba Fett has revealed his heroic side thanks to his antics in The Mandalorian Season 2 when he helped to save Grogu. But in the Book of Boba Fett, he pledges to rule Tatooine in a different way to the region's previous crime lord, Jabba the Hutt, stating that while his predecessor ruled with fear, he plans on ruling with respect. This is really strange because I can't see how a cutthroat bounty hunter can just completely change his tune. Or is it something from the events of what happened to him that has given him new life and then he's turned over a new leaf? After all, the Sarlacc nearly took his life. So maybe that has changed him and this is a different Boba Fett that we're seeing now. So what we know is happening in the universe is that Darth Vader's dead. Luke is still very much around the galaxy, starting the youngling Baby Yoda's training with the Force in The Mandalorian. So here's what I liked and what I didn't like. Firstly, there wasn't much action, as I've always preferred kind of exposition and story over action, which is what we got. It's been 38 years since the Return of the Jedi, so I'd like to know what he's been doing since then. And even if it means there's not much action, I'm signed up for that. Also, fleshing out Boba Fett's backstory is worth the 38 minutes that we get in this episode. And there's a big surprise too. Now, the Mandalorians and Tusken Raiders were found out in the Mandalorian series to have the most unexpected friendship in Star Wars. But we didn't really know why until this episode. Now, after the Jawas leave Boba Fett stranded in the desert, he's discovered by a tribe of Tusken Raiders who treat him as a prisoner. Now, there's some creatures that we see, like an armed beast emerging from the sand to fight Boba Fett. It looks like Goro in Mortal Kombat or Manchamp from Pokemon. And Boba Fett saves the Tusken youngling from the desert monster. Now, this starts off a new alliance that will eventually see Boba don the robes and weapons of the Tusken Raiders, like the gaffy stick that we see, yeah? That is an actual Tusken Raider stick. And it also explains why the Raiders are friends with the Mandalorians. So it's funny, because watching that, you kind of click, ah, oh, that's the reason why Mandor was friends with the Tusken Raiders. All of that was started from Boba Fett, so I'm really appreciate the fact that you've shown us that first. There's a certain pleasure in being back in the Star Wars universe because of that, because we're learning new things. In particular, we get the shot of Mos Espa. But the mission objective is clear. Boba Fett finding a new role as the crime lord of Tatooine. And while he intends to do some crime and dominate the local area, he isn't going to be racking up the body count and massing a pile of dead bodies to do his bidding. It's a more peaceful way, and that's why I can't really figure out whether this will work, because if you show a sign of weakness, then people are just going to try and abuse that and come for you. Yeah, they're going to look at him as a weak leader and think, yeah, let's take our chances because he ain't all that anymore. But for me, it's a fitting way to make him accountable in the universe for what he's done bad. And I'm interested to see if this series takes any more angles along the way. It would be interesting if another crime lord got in his way. Some of you guys know I'm talking about Darth Maul's Crimson Dawn from the end of the Han Solo movie. So we see Boba Fett use the Bacta tank to treat his injuries while his breathing apparatus may be reminiscent of Darth Vader or Luke Skywalker. It also explains why Boba's scars vanished when we saw him in The Mandalorian. So he's constantly going through this healing process to deal with the injuries he had in the Sarlacc pit. But we go back into the cantina as well and we see a much more smaller band than the 12 people that we saw in the original films. I guess this is the price of war. You know, there's been a big, massive intergalactic war with the Empire and the Rebellion, so I guess that this is how it was. You know, the couple of guys survived. But there might be a small Easter egg in there, and I'll explain. So when you guys saw Boba Fett with the Tusken Raiders, did you notice that he tried to fight one and got beaten? And this was a guy in a dark uniform, and he looked really, really skilled as well. So that might be a small Easter egg in Darth Krat. I'll explain. Asharad Het was a Jedi Master, and he was a Tusken Warlord, and the guy wears a black suit. I think that he's the guy that beats Boba Fett in the fight between them. I think it's more ambiguous for the people who have actually read the books and the comics. I think that this, again, another nod to those fans, and you gotta give respect to Dave Filoni and John Favreau for actually doing things like that, because they know that we are watching and this is all kind of stuff that we're seeing here. But if this is the case, then that could be Darth Krat, yeah? But moving forward, guys, I'd like to see more of a complex relationship between Fennec Shand and Boba Fett. At the moment, it's just kind of too nice and too easy. I'd like to see her ideals slightly differ from his. But if that doesn't happen, then I guess we'll have to accept it. Because remember, guys, Boba Fett saved Fennec Shand's life. So now she's in debt to him. So if nothing really happens, then, you know, it's not a big deal. But Temuera Morrison has been allowed to shine as a main character. I think this is the first time we've actually seen him in over 30 years. Because normally he plays second fiddle, you know, and then he played Jango Fett, he played Commander Cody, not to mention all the clones themselves. But we never really get to see him front and center. We don't get to see Boba Fett as the man himself. And much like the Mandalorian series, the Luke Skywalker scene ripping Death Troopers apart from the Mandalorian, fans are getting love letters from LucasArts. But what does this series really need to do in order for it to work? That's easy, guys. It needs a great antagonist. In The Mandalorian, we had Moff Gideon wielding the Darksaber. We also had the client in Season 1 that was trying to kidnap Baby Yoda Grogu and clone him. So I think for us, we need to understand that the villains in the Book of Boba Fett are ones to be reckoned with. And that's, for me, where the show needs to deliver. I would love it. It would be great if we saw Cura. Now, Cura was played by Emily Clarke in the Han Solo movie. Subsequently, she became the lieutenant in Crimson Dawn Syndicate until she takes control of the organization, becoming the leader during the Galactic War. There's also a question of where Rota is. Now, again, I'm going into Star Wars, Rebels, and Clone Wars for all of you TV viewers out there. Rota is Jabba's son. So what happened to him? He's the heir apparent to the Hutt Empire. So for me, guys, I give it a solid 7.5 out of 10. I love the Star Wars familiarity. We all love Star Wars. I just love being in that universe again. As we saw in The Mandalorian, I just hope that they bring in some of that old Star Wars feeling. In The Mandalorian series, we had Jedis, lightsaber battles, Beskar armor and weapons on show, new technology, we had aerial fights, different planets which looked amazing. So let's have some more space battles, please, guys. And fans love ships. We love ships. We fell in love with Mando's ship, and we love Boba Fett's ship in Slave One. But what's important, guys, is what did you think of this first episode? And do you think 7 episodes are enough? Let me know what you guys think in the comment section below, and I'll speak to you in the next one. Peace out.